sink into your holiness. When I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you. Joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthroned in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you. I worship you.
Good morning. Welcome, everyone. So the message that I'm going to share with you today is about the parable of the two sons. Okay. But before we begin, let's have a short prayer. Lord, thank you so much for this day. It's a big blessing to be in your presence again. And we ask, Father in heaven, that you give us the Holy Spirit to guide us and bless us as we study your word. May we learn a lot from this, Lord. So we ask this, Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, so this parable of the parable of the two sons is different from the parable of the prodigal son. So let's open our Bibles in Matthew chapter 21, verses 28 to 32. Okay, I'll read it for you. "But what do you think about this? A man with two sons told the older boy, 'Son, go out and work in the vineyard today.' The son answered, 'No, I don't want to go.' But later, he changed his mind and went anyway. Then the father told the other son, 'You go.' He said, 'Yes, sir, I will.' But he didn't go. Verse 31, which of the two obeyed his father? They replied, 'The first.' Then Jesus explained his meaning. 'I tell you the truth, corrupt tax collectors and prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you do.' Verse 32, for John the Baptist came and showed you the right way to live, but you didn't believe him, while tax collectors and prostitutes did. And even when you saw this happening, you refused to believe him and repent of your sins." So this story, let me give you a little bit of a background about this parable. So Jesus was in front of those religious leaders and elders of Israel, telling them this story that illustrates in the form of a parable. So this story represents two kinds of people in Israel. Okay, so there was this father who had two sons. This man represents God, our Heavenly Father himself. And these two sons that the Lord was talking about are the two types of people in Israel, in their society. So, first off, let's talk about the older or the first son. The father told the first son or his older son in verse 28, "Son, go out and work in the vineyard today." The son answered, "No, I won't go." But later, he changed his mind and went anyway. Okay, so here, the older son or the first son, according to our Lord Jesus, this represents in Israel the people whom they considered sinners in the society, such as the prostitute and the tax collectors. So these are the people in Israel who don't follow or obey God's commandment that was given by Moses back in the Old Testament, okay? Because in the commandment of God, for the people of Israel, here in Leviticus chapter 19 says, in verse 11, it says here, "Do not steal, do not deceive or cheat one another, which the tax collectors are not doing or not obeying." They were cheating people of their taxes. They are collecting taxes more or beyond the requirements of the Roman Empire. So what are they doing, these tax collectors? The excess money or the rest of the money, after giving it to the Roman Empire, they're putting it in their own pocket. Okay, so this is what they're doing. They're cheating one or deceiving other people. And also in Leviticus chapter 11, also in this verse, in verse 29, it states here that, "Do not defile your daughter by making her a prostitute, or the land will be filled with prostitution and wickedness." Which again, brothers and sisters, that the prostitutes are guilty of not doing this commandment of Moses. So these are the examples of people who represent the first son whom the Lord was talking about in the parable. Okay? But you know the good news, guys, is this is. But later on, these people who are considered sinners in the society, the good news is these people of Israel, the tax collectors and the prostitutes, when they heard the calling of God to repent from their sins through John the Baptist, they realized their sins and repented from it and started to obey God's commandment. Amen. Praise God, no? So to illustrate this kind of example, no, that there's this tax collector during the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, no, here in the Bible, there's this chief tax collector named Zacchaeus that the Lord met and had dinner with him. His name again is Zacchaeus. Okay, he became very rich for collecting taxes. No, so one day, Zacchaeus was so excited because Jesus asked him that Jesus wanted to go to his house and have dinner with him. So you can see this scenario in Luke chapter 19, verse 8 to 9. Let's look at verse 6 here. Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. But the people were displeased. He has gone to be the guest of a notorious sinner. They grumbled, no? So when people back then, they saw Jesus having dinner with Zacchaeus, a notorious sinner back then, they were displeased. Because back then, they don't mingle people, they don't socialize with people who are called sinners. Okay? So meanwhile, while Zacchaeus was having dinner with Jesus, there's this good news, no, that something Zacchaeus realized. And this is what he said. In verse 8, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord and said, "I will give half of my wealth to the poor, Lord. And if I have cheated people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much." So imagine this. In verse 9, this is what the Lord said about Zacchaeus, about what Zacchaeus said. Jesus responded, "Salvation has come to this home today, for this man has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham." And verse 10, "For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who are lost." So look at this, brothers and sisters. The purpose of our Lord Jesus Christ is really to come and save us, to seek the lost. He didn't come here to condemn people, but to seek them and save them. Zacchaeus realized his sins and decided to repent from it. Then that's the time the Lord saved him. Wow, this is a great story. This tax collector, Zacchaeus, is a perfect example of the first son or the older son. After saying to his father, "No, I won't go to the vineyard." But later, he realized his mistakes and obeyed his father. Amen. All right, so now let's talk about the second son. In verse 30 of Matthew 21, then the father told the other son, the second son, by the way, "You go," and he said, "Yes, sir, I will." But he didn't go. The second son, according to our Lord, this represents those religious leaders and elders of Israel. Okay? Let's read verse 31. This is what the Lord told them. "I tell you the truth. Corrupt tax collectors and prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you do." In verse 32, he said this to them, "For John the Baptist came and showed you the right way to live, but you didn't believe him, while tax collectors and prostitutes did. And even when you saw this happening, you refused to believe him and repent from your sins." No? So this is the scenario here. These religious leaders and elders of Israel who said yes to the Lord, that they will obey God's commandment, but actually, brothers and sisters, they didn't. For example, the Word of God says, repent. They said, yes, we will repent. We believe in the repentance from sin. But they don't. They didn't repent. No. They speak of believing in God, but they didn't believe in the Son of God, our Lord Jesus Christ. And deep inside, this is what's going on in them. They have this hidden sin. But they portray to this to other people that they are holy and righteous. But Jesus sees or saw their wickedness in their hearts. Okay, and Jesus called them this in Matthew 23:27-28, verse 27, what sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled on the inside with dead people's bones and all sorts of impurity. Outwardly, look at this, brothers and sisters. In verse 20, outwardly, you look like righteous people, but inwardly, your hearts are filled with hypocrisy and lawlessness. The religious leaders were good at talking righteous living, but deep inside, they don't live righteously. They are more of a religious appearance. And their hearts are not right with God. Now, Jesus asked them this, no? Which do you think was the one who obeyed the Father? And this is their answer. It's correct. The first son. It's a good answer. But now, they realize that they're the ones whom the Lord pertains as the second son who said yes, but yet disobeyed the Father. Amen. So now we know who's the first and the second son. So what are the lessons, brothers and sisters, that we can get from this parable of the two sons? First of all, there are two kinds of sinners in this world. The first sinner is a sinner with publicly exposed sins. Their sins are revealed just like the tax collectors and the prostitutes. And the other sinners are the one with secret sins or hidden sins, such as the religious leaders and the elders of Israel. No? Again, brothers and sisters, there are only two kinds of people in this world. The one with exposed sin, okay, and the one with secret sins. There's no one in the middle. Either your sins are exposed or your sins are hidden, okay? Now, the question here, which side are we here? What kind of sinner are we? We are. Are we in the publicly revealed sin? Or are we the ones whose sins are hidden? But let's read first Romans 3:23-24, okay? According to this verse, guys, for everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standards. So it means here that all of us are sinners. It's either your sins are revealed or your sins are hidden. Yet, this is the good news, brothers and sisters. Yet God, in His grace, freely makes us right in His sight. He did this through whom? Through Christ Jesus, when He freed us. He freed us from the penalty of our sins. So without the love and the sacrifice of our Lord on the cross, until now, we are dying of our sins. Okay? But praise God, my brothers and sisters. Praise God because the Lord Jesus stays here that He freed us. We are no longer be penalized from our sins. Amen? Wow. So this is the lesson that we can learn from the first son, brothers and sisters. The first son said, no, he won't go to the vineyard. But look at our Father in heaven. You see how good our Father in heaven here. In this situation, we saw a loving Father that He's so patient waiting for us until such time that we realize our sins, until such time that we said yes to Him. You know, God understands really our situations, that we, you know, we are lost. And you know what our Heavenly Father is doing? He's not forcing us to obey Him. He's just there, waiting patiently for us to realize everything, that there's no joy and peace in these worldly pleasures. God's love and kindness lead us to repentance, brothers and sisters. You know, just like Zacchaeus, it's hard to give up this life of pleasure, especially when you're earning money, you're gaining money from collecting taxes. No? It's really hard. That's really hard. But when he saw he's in the presence of God, he felt the love of Jesus and the forgiveness of Jesus, and he surrendered everything. That's what Zacchaeus did. And now he found true joy and love, or eternal joy, in the arms of our Lord Jesus Christ, okay? In the arms of our Heavenly Father. That's what the lessons we can learn here. God is patiently waiting for us. He didn't force us to obey, but He waited so much for us until such time that we repent from our sins. Hallelujah! Praise God. And what can we learn also from the second son? We can learn here in the second son that action is better than words. Right now, people don't need a lot of sermons and preachings. You know what God wants to see, especially to us who believe in Jesus? They want to see changed lives. They want to see the miracle of God in us. Okay, Christianity is not just a religious external activity only, but it is a change of heart, that there's a miracle deep inside us, a miracle happening inside us. Okay, more people are so prayerful, religiously attending church and reading the Bible, but some of them, they didn't really surrender themselves or everything to the Lord. They are still the captain of their souls or their lives. So, brothers and sisters, surrender yourselves to the Lord and let Him be the Lord of your lives or the captain of your soul. Amen? So, now in our generation also, there are people, we heard from news, especially religious leaders also, who were caught committing different kinds of sins, corruptions, immoralities. But don't lose heart, brothers and sisters. Don't lose heart. What we should do now is we should surrender everything to the Lord, including all our sins, and let God heal us. Allow God to change us through the power of the Holy Spirit. We really need the help of God. So in this parable of the two sons, brothers and sisters, God wants us not only to be saved from our sins, but God loves us so much that He wants to give us true joy, peace, and abundant blessings. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. I want to pray for you now. Father in heaven, we give glory to You, for You revealed to us how loving and patiently You waited for us until such time we realize our mistakes. Thank You, Lord God. We humble ourselves in front of You now, Father. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we humble ourselves. And we pray for those people who are now living in sin, Lord God. We pray that they will let them realize how good life is together with You, that there's joy, peace, and blessings in Your arms. And there's only distractions if they live in sin, Lord. So thank You, Lord Jesus. Bless them and show them, Lord God, Your love and Your salvation for these people who are lost. Why? Because You came in this world, Lord Jesus, to seek and save the lost. Thank You for that great love. Thank You, Father in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
When all things that surround become shadows in the light of You. you.